We have now arrived at that most dreaded day in the year, the Super Bowl. That's what I fear the most of any day of the year. And but I am well prepared, and I'm trying to do my best here too. If modern culture needs any greater condemnation, I don't know what it could possibly be, right? This great celebration of modern culture. It seems like this modern culture is the only culture in history it's not aware of the restricted intensity zones and the capacity to ascend to those. And we call ourselves advanced. Advanced in what? Advanced in absurdity is what we're advanced in, this culture. And the Super Bowl is a celebration of absurdity, really. So, I spent this morning, in profound contemplation. And what I did was I went through layer after layer after layer of objection and resolved it into direct spaciousness without any process, no horizontalness at all. Just everything as it is released in the now. As it is, just. And then another defense came up, and another defense, and I kept dissolving these defenses. This is what contemplation does. Meditation's a little different. Meditation, but this is what contemplation does. And so I arrived at this one more defense, and this defense was simply contrasting labels, symbols, labels, and the presumed contrast between labels. I realized the entire flimsy structure of absurdity is defended by our willingness to believe that there's a contrast between labels. And then I said, ah, okay. That's as far as I got. I didn't go past that because I don't think there's any past that. I think that's the final defense, really. I recognize, oh, that's the final defense. Okay, all right. Now, prior to this contemplation, I had a dream last night. I was in San Jose, and I was supposed to drive somewhere, deliver something. So I'm looking for Kirtner Avenue. And I see Kirtner starts, and then I get onto this other street. It turns in this other street, and I said, well, what happened to Kirtner? I don't know. And I look at the street sign, and it says Highland. I said, well, this must be Kirtner. It's going in the same direction, I said, so might as well take it. I don't know what happened to Kirtner. So I was going in towards San Jose. And we start to go up in this little hilly area. And I said, okay. And then there start to be these trees, these beautiful big trees. And I said, that's odd. I don't remember there being a hill here in San Jose in the direction I'm going. I said, maybe I've lived here my whole life, but maybe I've missed it. I don't know. So we keep driving through this, and it's this beautiful wooded area with these gorgeous trees and scenery. And then I start feeling like, you know, I just don't think that there's anything like this in San Jose. What is going on here? And so I keep driving, and we come out of this wooded area into the valley. It looks like Santa Clara Valley or something. But I look around all the mountains ringing the valley, and I said, these aren't the mountains of Santa Clara Valley. And they're all have different these different shapes and forms and colors. It's like very surreal. I said, I'm not familiar with any mountains that look like this, actually, in the world, really. And so I was still driving on the street, and I just said, this is really, I wonder where I am. It looks similar, everything looks similar, but everything, that also there's dissimilarity too. So I pull into the first place I see. I think maybe I need gas. I see, oh, there's a gas station. That's familiar. Let me pull in the gas station. I'm going to ask him, where am I? That's what I wanted to ask the people in the gas station. I saw, like, you know, a mechanic area and gas pumps and all this stuff. It's a gas station. So I pull in there, and I get out, and I look at the gas pumps, and everything looks the same except there are no handles to put gas in your vehicle. And so I asked the man, I said, what's up with this? Is this a new system? How do we get gas? And he goes, well, he kind of gave me this nondescript answer that didn't really answer much of anything. And I looked around and I said, this is, everything's different. There's a difference everywhere here. Where am I? Now keep in mind that the road I saw myself on was called Highland Road. So I was in some other realm. I'd just driven, smoothly driven into some other realm. Now there was just one little moment of sort of confusion while I was on Kirtner Avenue, and then it looked like there was a turn here. I said, oh, wait a minute, there's a turn, I turn, okay, I'm still going the same direction. Where I seemed to turn off of Kirtner, and it seemed to stop. It seemed to stop. I said, well, where's it go? And so I was going in the same direction, it seemed like, but on a slightly parallel road. So that was the beginning of it. But I still felt I was still going right where I needed to go. All right? But I actually arrived in a higher land, a higher realm than this realm. So I was literally in a higher realm last night. My consciousness went through this experience. Now, later on in the morning, something suddenly dawns upon me. Wow. Very, very important insight. So we're going to bring this up at least, just touch upon it here. We're not necessarily going to try to generalize it at this point. Okay, that I didn't try to do that. It was too much for me. We're just going to take the gas station as an example, because that's where I first stopped. And I realized that in this realm, there's no need for gas. There's no need for gas. But what we do is we want to keep the familiarity around us. And so we still have gas stations, and you can still pull into the gas station. Say, oh, I'm going to pull into the gas station. Except there's no gas. And so we can spend some time there like we're gassing up, although we're not, and then we can leave again. And it's a familiar habit we have from the lower realm. And yet there's something different about it, in that in this realm, everything we want, we just have it, already have it. But that's too frightening for us. So this is a reduced intensity zone that I went into. And I actually focused on doing that before I went to bed. This has been my focus. I want to visit a reduced intensity realm. And I did it. I did it. So everything seems pretty much the same as this realm, except for these few little differences. And I just bring up the gas station to start out with, but to give the general idea. So what here in this realm, we say, I have a need. I need gas. Where's the gas station? There's a gas station. I pull in the gas station and get gas. There, you might say, maybe I should think about getting gas. It doesn't seem, the intensity doesn't seem so important. You say, well, maybe I don't need gas. But just, because of the old habits, I say, well, let me just at least pull into a gas station. Okay. Now, pulling into a gas station, that satisfies the reduced intensity that maybe I still have a need. So at least I'm going to play as if still have that need to a certain extent. So pulling into a gas station and maybe getting out of the car and looking at the gas pumps there, you say, ah, okay. And then you kind of say, well, yeah, I didn't put any gas in the car, but that's okay. So are you getting this? Maybe it will click at some point. This is what we're talking about in a reduced intensity zone. Our valuing of time is greatly reduced. So we might have the feeling like maybe I need to get gas, so then maybe I need to go in a gas station. Okay, now maybe I can leave like this. Okay, maybe things are okay for a while now. And so this maybe, 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 maybe-ness. And we never do actually get gas, but we're always, we still have the feeling, well, maybe at some point I might need to get gas. It's possible. So there's a gas station. So maybe the gas station has gas, and maybe going there, you know, but by going through this, it pushes the maybe into the future, kind of. Well, okay, so I'm okay for now. I'm okay for now. I don't really need gas now. I satisfied the maybe. And this is the way that life is lived there. I asked the guy, is this some new technology? I didn't see, this wasn't electricity or wire. So what is this technology? And he couldn't really, he said, no, we just, this is the way we do it here. Yeah, this is how it is. I said, I was just thinking, that's odd. I don't see any means to charge a car up with electricity or put gas in it or do anything. But the pumps are all there, except it just lacks the cord and the handle, you know, to actually do it. There's nothing to plug electrical car in or anything. But everything else seems the same, very similar. It's like a dummy gas station, you know, in a movie set or something. So at that point, I realized, wow, is this something in the future? At first, I thought this is like our future. But then I realized, wait a minute, no, there's something different. This is not our future, really, in this world. It's something else. And this is a reduced intensity zone. Now, getting there was quite pleasant. It was a beautiful trip through these beautiful trees. Very gentle hills, very gentle hill, very gentle area. So, in just recounting this, I feel this is very great intensity. It's almost scary, the intensity, like, wow, I did that. Kind of like driving into Death Valley. I remember driving to that. It was very intense. Turned out to be a beautiful place, actually. Maybe if you don't go there in the summertime. It was the wintertime. It was like 85. It was actually rained a little bit when I was there. It was beautiful clouds. Oh, it was gorgeous. But I felt the intensity, like, wow, this is, you know, what am I doing? So when I was driving in there, the reduced intensity zone, I just felt like, well, I need to get there, so it's important. I need to deliver something. So I got to keep driving. I got to get there. I'm just not sure exactly, you know, where I am, but I'll find it. I feel like, well, I'll find it. I know I'm going in the right direction, so it's not a problem. And it gradually dawned upon me, like, this is a different realm, but I still thought, well, I can still deliver what I need to deliver. But then I began to realize that, you know, there's something fundamentally different about this place. So you can imagine, you know, the intensity I'm feeling now. And I just have to make it the new normal. Very timely to experience this and the intensity of it. And then let the initial shock wear off. This is what we have to do. We have to brave. We have to be brave. We have to brave being a pioneer in new territory and then let the shock wear off. There isn't any other way around it. You have to break the ice like this. And then you pay a price. Gorgeous day today here in California. It's just spectacular. Chamber of Commerce Day for the Super Bowl. Everybody's going to be watching the Chamber of Commerce Day. I'm sure they'll show blimp shots of, you know, the whole Bay Area and Golden Gate Bridge and everyone. They'll just say, look, folks, look at this great place. But it's really not that great. We were thinking about that last night. Where do we go today? And if you don't like the ocean and the beach, let's say someone doesn't like the ocean and beach, okay, this whole side is just shut off. And if you don't like Santa Cruz, which I don't, I don't like the vibe there, we don't go to that whole area. Santa Cruz, Capitola, Aptos, Soquel, that whole area, just very, the vibe is not something that I entertain at all. so that's off limits, and that's the ocean area anyway. And then you think, well, San Francisco, I don't like, you know, I don't like the vibe of San Francisco either. I don't like the big city, so that's off limits. Berkeley, Oakland's definitely off limits. We won't go there at all. Wine country, I'm not a wine drinker. I don't drink wine, so we don't go wine tasting or anything like that. So that's out. Don't go to the mountains. Don't really like the big mountains. That's a kind of a weird, a lot of weird people, a weird vibe in the Santa Cruz Mountains, very much so. I don't want to go into it, but it's not a place I'm interested in going at all. So I'm thinking, where do I want to go in the Bay Area? And we couldn't think of any place, you know, to go. I was consulting, and it's like, wow. Is this really such a great place? You go across the Golden Bridge a few times. You do the tourist stuff. I mean, I've lived here my whole life. I've done everything. And there's nothing I can think of I want to do here in this area. Nothing. And that was last night. I got so agitated. I said, my gosh, I want to go to another world. I realized there's nothing I want to do in this world. This is the truth. I really don't feel, if someone asks me, what do you want to do? I'm trying to think, how do we escape the Super Bowl? Get out of this area. Well, there's really no place to go other than down in the desert. But that's too far of a drive for just a day excursion. As far as a day excursion, there's no place. No place at all. And I was really depressed, super depressed about this. Then I put my attention on some great spiritual teaching. I found some really great spiritual teaching. Put my attention onto it. And I sort of came out of that mood and went to bed in a very positive mood. But the desire was, I got to find a better world than this world. We're told the Bay Area is the best place in the world. Well, I've had enough of the Bay Area. I've had almost 60 years here. And it's just, the thrill is gone. The thrill is gone. And by extension, the thrill in this world is gone too, really. I mean, wherever you go, it's fundamentally the same here, really. So I had this desperate desire to find another realm. And so then in this dream, I actually journeyed to this other realm. It's difficult to describe the mountains there. It's very difficult to describe them. They're very beautiful. They're like honeycomb, so to speak, almost like. I wonder if these are all like caves or something, or places to sit and meditate or contemplate in all the mountains. They kind of look like that. It's very beautiful, like intricate. There's a place in California, 395. It's called what, the church rocks, the church spires, or cathedral, something like that. It's a state park or national park, and the stones, the way they've eroded, it produces all these incredible patterns that look like some Baroque church or something like that. It's just amazing. The mountains kind of look like that. Very beautifully ornate sort of appearance to them, with different colors, or pink and green and all these different colors of the mountains. So I wonder, if you could go in the mountains, and it seems like there might be millions and millions of these beautiful alcoves in the mountains. It looks like there was honeycomb with all these alcoves. Imagine mountains made out of honeycomb, and so you could sit in one of these beautiful alcoves and look out over all the beautiful landscape there in very peaceful, temperate atmosphere. Now, there was a big valley. I don't know if I saw any ocean, if there was a bay or not. Maybe two, maybe later. So, question is, do I play golf later now? Well, maybe not. Maybe not. Maybe not. I don't want to be pressed. I don't want to be pressed when I do a video. I don't want to be under any sort of time pressure. That's very bad. We need to get this information out. This is very significant development historically here. I was able to do a very smooth journey into another realm. Reduced intensity realm. And we're starting to get acquainted with it. So it appeared as though there were houses, like just like the Silicon Valley, Santa Clara Valley, houses, all these houses. But again, I got the impression, sort of just the peripheral impression, that there's something a little different. That the houses seem more like a movie set. That I'm not sure that there were people living in the houses, or that the houses actually were functional. I'm not sure if there was really utilities going into the houses, being utilized, or... So I felt everything was just a little bit different, like walking to a movie set. Oh, wait a minute. Now maybe there were there telephone phones and wires? Maybe. I'm not sure if I recognize that or not. But it's possible that we spend our time in the mountains, in these alcoves, in contemplation. And that we only have these homes to say, well, if I need a home, there it is. So, maybe I'll need it later. So we may visit our homes. These homes may be just some place that we visit, just like we visit a gas station. But they're not really functional. Like the gas station didn't really have gas. Because let's say, well, maybe I need to eat. If I need to eat, I know there's a kitchen. Great. Well, there may not be no. No, the stove may not work, the water may not work, nothing really may work. Just like the gas station didn't have a pump. But we say, well, if I need it, you know, maybe it's here. Yeah. And you feel like, okay, we feel reassured. Like, okay, there's a house, there's a kitchen. And then we go back to our contemplation. Now, this is the first time I've ever entertained this sort of scenario. It seemed like I look in the mountains in a distance. It seems like they were like exquisite. It's quite extraordinary, and yet the valley seemed very blah. Just like you know, Santa Clara Valley is very blah, and most valleys are just valleys, right? And so it seemed like I said, "Wow, the mountains seem way more interesting than the valley here." That's why I'm wondering. I'm wondering if we don't spend our time in the mountains there. And they may be just incredibly beautiful. Now, I happened to be in a tile store a couple days ago. And I was in the warehouse, back in the warehouse, where they have all the slabs, the huge slabs. They're about like 6 feet by maybe 12 feet, something, maybe less, maybe 10 or something like that. But they're big slabs. These are big slabs. These are used in showers and countertops, whatever. And it's always amazing to look at these slabs. And I went around looking at them. I just said, well, I'm trying to find the ones most expensive. But I was just looking at all of them. The one that was most expensive I found was this azure blue slab. All the stone was blue. Everything was blue. It was so extraordinary. And then there was this Eye of Inca slab that was just absolutely amazing, with green and stratifications of brown tones. I mean, and the lady at the desk was just pointing to some granite at the desk, and I said, how'd you do that? She says, well, they masted off, they sandblasted, put a template on, they sandblasted part, and then they burnished the part that was not sandblasted. So they're able to make designs now in stone, using, she calls it burnishing, but polishing, burnishing and sandblasting. So you're literally looking here at stone that can have the most intricate pictures and details in it now. But the slabs are out of this world. I mean, you just cannot believe that this stuff came from this world. Every sort of dark shade, you know, the black stone, dark stone, every color and shade under the sun, in the most amazing patterns. Some of them look like you're looking from an airplane at the Amazon Delta or something, you know, just, So I'm aware that stone can have a just almost unlimited amount of textures. That's why people love tile, putting tile in their house. You know, it really dresses it up, doesn't it? This natural stone and tile. Well, tile is not natural. It's manufactured, a lot of it, right? But they're doing some very clever stuff with tile also, and porcelain. But these mountains could be, the potential for beauty in these mountains I saw could just be something that is just mind-blowing, that we could spend a lot of time there. As we contemplate, we're in an atmosphere of just extraordinary natural beauty. It's not mind. It's not like a house where you get a slab and then you put it in your shower or something like that. There's a place like in California called Pinnacles National Monument, and I've hiked all the way through there. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful. Stone. Beautiful stone. I tend to like rock, stone, the beauty for it, beauty of it. Taking the aerial tram up, but going up past these beautiful stones, it's just like, oh my God, it's so beautiful. I love stones and rock like that. It's extraordinary, isn't it? How everything here, it was like just melted together, and pressure and everything just creates all these patterns, this unbelievable variety of patterns. And of course, we have been working on stone throughout our history, have we not? Have we not been stone workers throughout most of our history? Have we not been intrigued by it? So we do have this long-standing habit of that stone is beautiful. I mean, the more money we have, the more marble we put in our house, right? Still going on. The wealthy people here, they're just continue to put more and more expensive tile patterns in their house. The tile patterns now are extraordinary. I mean, there's just one tile pattern I was looking at, and it looked like it was all different heights and of the tile. There were little square pieces in this pattern, and each one had a different height to it. I said, wow, that's quite complex. And then I put my hand on it, it was all smooth. I said, what? And they had put clear tile on top of something that had color to it, with all different depths of this color. So it looked like there was all this depth of texture, and in fact, it was smooth. It was all smooth, which makes it easier to clean, of course, and grout it. You can grout it. See, it's all groutable and cleanable, and yet it has the illusion of all this depth to it. It's like, wow. You know, that's very clever. I mean, there's just all, I said, who's doing all this designing? There's a constant flow of designs in tile in the world that are really mind-blowing, you know, just aesthetically. So imagine that all just natural, but way beyond anything we have in this world, where you can literally live in a cave, a beautiful alcove, or contemplate there, like a meditation space. And you're just surrounded everywhere you look. It's just different patterns, different textures, different appearances of this gorgeous stone. And it's just, wow. So, it's so beautiful there, we feel like we don't even want to go to any house or anything like that. It's way superior. Way superior. I can understand that. Way superior. But the habit we have is so strong about houses as our dwelling places that we want to at least have a dummy house that's ours. To say, well, this is my house, I own it. But I just visit it occasionally just to reassure myself, reassure the old habit, right? So, well, maybe if I want to go back to housing, I can do that. I still have a house. This is this realm. Maybe if I want to go to a gas station, maybe I want to gas up, there's a gas station. Maybe if I want to live in a house, there's a house. But right now, I don't really want to do that. This is a reduced intensity zone. So we're getting a much clearer picture now of this. And we can bring our attention to recognizing that all of absurdity, it just rests upon the presumed contrast of labels. Labels are really entirely arbitrary. And so is the presumption that labels contrast. Without this, there would just be Alpha Pure Guru Vision, for sure. So we may not be quite ready for Alpha Pure Guru Vision. We might, these reduced intensity zones are designed to help us in that way. This is, at least this is the premise that I'm looking at. It's kind of like, well, if we want to go back to the world, we can do so. But we don't really, so, well, it's, maybe if I want to go back, maybe I can. It's still, the gas station's still there. If I want to pull into a gas station and think about gassing up my car, I can do that. If I want to go to a house and think about living there, I can do so. But I don't really want to live there. So it's sort of a reduced intensity zone where we haven't totally let go of the belief in contrast of labels, because really, this is what all this whole realm, all this absurdity is all based on this. That's the foundation it rests upon. So we need to ultimately recognize this and then ultimately, you know, realize that all labels are equally released in the now, inherently so, that from that standpoint, there's no contrast at all. It's all simultaneous. It's always been the case. It's the same truth we apply to all their defenses. But when we get to this defense about just arbitrarily, you know, just imagining that there's contrast among labels, so maybe this zone helps us with that. And there may be, you know, well, I recognized a lot in this contemplation this morning. I seemed to go through just about all defenses except this final one that I just recognized. Okay, that too. But then I realized if I get through that one, it's just bliss. It's just bliss. So it may be that this reduced intensity zone is a place where, once we get used to it and feel it's home for us, then we can go to a pure land, a death-free realm, pure land, and we feel we can go back to this zone if we want to, where there is this beautiful contrast of appearances. And so that can be my home too. We feel at home there. And maybe that'll then help us go beyond this whole contrast of labels defense that we have. Yeah, the colors I saw in those mountains, I said, wow, this is not the world, you know. This is something, this is quite extraordinary. You could say that maybe they'll all be jeweled in more, you know. I mean, you could have these faces of rocks and slabs there in the mountains, as it's honeycombed, that are like quartz with massive amounts of diamonds in them, but it's like burnished, you know. It's smooth. It's smoothed out so it all you know reflects the light beautifully. You can have rubies, and all the gems in this world are all just naturally embedded in all the stone in patterns, in natural patterns, free flowing natural patterns of all different types. And not a thought of possessing these or grasping these or anything there. You just let it be and just enjoy it just as it is. Because it's mere appearance. You can't take a saw and cut it, actually. You cannot manufacture anything in this realm. Any tool you would have to try cut, it's just mere appearances also, and you just, you know, just kind of like a rainbow, just kind of vanish as you try to cut it. So everything there is just, it's not to be exploited, it's not to be ground up, it's not to be put into some materialistic process. It's like a pristine natural park. This whole realm is like a global natural park, national park, global park, just a global park where you leave no footprints. So I've been doing these graphics using the paintings of Nicholas Roerich, which seem to, better than any other artist, point to this reduced intensity zone. Points to a reduced intensity zone, the Himalayan mountains paintings, the beautiful stone juxtapositions that he painted. And then I'm putting these together, putting like four or more together and into a different collage, like, which, and then having figures in those. And very profound to work on this. It's helped me get ready for a reduced intensity zone. So all thanks to Nicholas Roerich and those people who've made these paintings available to us. Of course, he was one of the first Westerners to go into the Tibetan culture there. And of course, the Tibetan culture is very aware of that at that time. Reduced intensity zones, they're super, super advanced, to say the least. Not all of it. I mean, you know, the whole ball of wax was there, but he saw some very interesting stuff, and he was a brilliant, brilliant painter, my favorite painter, Nicholas Roerich. And let it be known that he has been very helpful. His efforts, you know, at some point, people might say, oh, it's a nice painting, but subconsciously, this has been getting into us subconsciously, and it certainly has got into me. I've been working with his paintings for quite some time now, and I always have enormous resonance with me. Yeah, he was an astonishing genius painter, to say the least. Spiritual, the meta message of his paintings there is heavily resonating with reduced intensity zone. He may have come here from a reduced intensity zone to help us out, very likely. That's why he hung out in Tibet with those who came and went from reduced intensity zones and higher zones, actually. These advanced spiritual beings can just leave a body in a cave somewhere, and they can be their consciousness. They can be functioning in another body, some other zone, or many zones, actually simultaneously. And then when they need to function this zone, the body comes out of its meditation. They just awaken the body, and then they move about here. And then people don't even realize that they weren't even here, or that they were functioning in other zones, other realms. So Rorik spent his time there. He had to have been from this reduced intensity zone to paint the way he painted, because he evoked it. It was very evocative of what I saw. Very evocative. Now, I saw him at a distance, but enough of my attention was there as a peripheral attention. Like, I was like, hey, this is what I'm interested in. But I said, but I'm supposed to deliver to some house. I said, wait a minute. So I'm thinking, well, maybe I'll deliver a little later. Let's check these mountains out first. So the idea is that labels can cast shade upon one another is totally made up in our mind. But this casting shade produces a hierarchy of subtlety, does it not? At least imaginary. And so this whole belief in stratifications of subtlety is the delusion that we're under. And we're trying to generate an artificial bliss, actually, from this. And I saw how this leads then to embodiment. I saw the whole thing very clearly. And I didn't struggle with it. I just said resolved it into the now, right now. But it was this label thing where we were just imagining that one label casts shade on another. In other words, contrast. There's some sort of contrast there. This is just totally arbitrarily to just presume this. It's not actually taking place at all. Every label is just the same. It's just intrinsic decoration of its own spaciousness. The one spaciousness. That is the same spaciousness. It's just wishful thinking on our part entirely. So, but if we drop that, we're literally, then that's alpha pure guru vision for sure. It's true bliss. And by trying to stratify to believe in subtlety, we think then the highest subtlety, that's where the bliss is, and the rest is not blissful. This is how we try to manufacture fake bliss. Actually, right now, all is blissful. There's only pure bliss everywhere. At all moments. It's present right now. But we're denying that, and we're trying to manufacture a fake bliss as a base for a new creation that we can create. We're the prime creator. We have our own bliss that we like better. We're trying to make a bliss that we like better than pure bliss of reality. And this is what this whole existence and all these stratifications of subtlety, this gross embodiment and then subtler embodiments, all of that is all part of this attempt. And it doesn't work. That's why even when we, afterlife, we go into these subtler realms, we ultimately are frustrated and furiously go back into embodiment to try and make it more gross, to throw more shade, more contrast upon the higher, upon the subtleties, so we can feel, oh, this is so much more subtle than the gross down there. So what they really, truly are trying to do is make this gross, more dense, more dark. This is what's happening now in this world. This is what the spiritual coup here in this world is all about. As I said, it brings in this black hole, where the contrast, supposedly, between this black, gross, dense, really horrible hole. And by the way, many people have pointed out that women are becoming more and more gross, and they most certainly are. I mean, they wouldn't in the past go within miles of like a locker room, a male locker room. Now they've made it their home, and they're just, you know, they're just so much grosser than they used to be women. They're so much grosser. That's the push of the body, to make the body more gross, so that it can contrast with the so-called subtlety of the higher subtle realms. And then they think that contrast will have a meaning, that this is the new bliss that satisfies us. But it never does. So then we just have to try to make it even more gross, more contrast. And we play all these games of contrast. But really, there's no contrast at all. It's all just our presumption, wishful thinking. Everything is already exactly as it is, totally released in the now, with no throwing no shade upon anything whatsoever. And this is what I saw, and I was able to dissolve the whole flesh. The flesh would arise, I dissolve it back into the release in the now, and it disappeared. Then it came back and disappeared. I realized, okay, I can do that. It's no problem. But then the highest deception is simply the wishful thinking that there's any contrast between labels at all. And to believe that there is to be trapped in samsara, the cycles of existence. Inherently so, because we're involved in this make-believe of contrast, of higher and lower, lightness and darkness. Keep in mind, the true light is the clear light. There's no contrast. How can you contrast clear light? The fake light is this white light, we call it the white light, and then the dark light, the play of that. That's all, again, imaginary. The white light is just a decoration of its own spaciousness, exactly as the dark light is a decoration of its own spaciousness. I mean, dark appearance. The white appearance and the black appearance, for instance, are again just decorations of their own clear light spaciousness. There's no contrast at all between the two. They're exactly the same in their spaciousness, their mere appearances. So when this is realized, then this is ultimate liberation. So we most here are not ready for ultimate liberation. But we don't really want to go down into the grosser, make our, go with this culture which is trying to make a grosser realm, which the Super Bowl represents. Does it not? It's here in the Silicon Valley. It's no coincidence that in this spiritual coup that is planned for this year 2016, that the rallying point, the Church of Grossness, will take its traveling roadshow and put it right here in Levi Stadium in Santa Clara, which is the heart of Silicon Valley. And that the attention of the world is upon this, because Silicon Valley is the slickness that is camouflaging the grossness. Okay, it's part of the spiritual coup that's taking place in this world. Coup d'etat. So, that's no coincidence. They're highlighting, but look how, you know, slick grossness can be. I mean, the game is gross, okay? But they're saying, look how slick grossness can be. And you got all these women reporters now, they're swarming every athlete now. They're asking like the majority of the questions. Oh, hey, can't, hey, hey, hey. It's like saying, look how sexy, look how slick, look how beautiful, look how attractive all this gross is. I'm totally attracted to it. Yeah, the women say, I'm so attracted to grossness. You know, wow, really turns me on, this grossness. And then they're saying, you know, don't worry, grossness will be a big turn on too. You're going to love it. You're going to love it. This is the play. This is the play. And this comes from the highest level of subtlety, with frustration that it can't feel the bliss, that it can't really feel bliss. says, we must have more grossness. The highest level of the so-called subtlety, contrast subtlety, is what you call the Antichrist or Lucifer or anything like that. You just, that's just a term that is used. The frustrations, you know, the orders, you know, for this delusion come from there. Say, we must have more grossness. But it's really just this frustration and fear and frustration that we haven't succeeded yet. So you have a situation where the world is going into more grossness, very severe more grossness. Heavily, heavily. You just look at the entertainment, everything. It has just been a free fall. A free fall. It used to be a lot of music like classic country, a lot of it talking about, you know what, I really prefer the higher realms. This realm's really terrible. I can't wait until I leave this place. A lot of the songs are like that. They came from gospel, it came from spirituals, they came from church music, it came from all of this tradition, like, you know, wow, this realm here is totally gross, I hate it. I'd much prefer to be in the higher realms, so I can't wait to leave this place. But there was no real insight into it all, because the so-called subtler realms are still entirely part of this whole delusion, whereas the reduced intensity zones are something different. That comes from the grace of God. Those are liberating realms. So the reduced intensity zones are not the zones that you enter into after you die, necessarily. Okay? You enter into these when you have the consciousness of what the purpose of them is to free us from absurdity. Now, it's true, after you die, you feel in a less gross realm. But these less gross realms are all part of this attempt to create this fake bliss, a new bliss, a different bliss than the one bliss that's always present. So that doesn't do anything to release you from this cycle, this chain of subtlety, or chain of contrast, imaginary contrast. It doesn't do anything to release you from that. It's just like giving you vacation from the grossness. But you're still, you know, you're like a tread on a tractor. And you say, oh, I'm out of the mud now, you know. But that tread is going towards, you know, the front of the tractor, and it's going to, you know, it's going to be back in the mud again. You know, those like a caterpillar tractor, those treads that they have on them. That's what it's like. Imagine you're just hooked up to this big tractor in the garbage dump with mud, and you're going, and then the tread goes over the front wheel, and then it's down in the garbage in the mud, and it's, you know, giving the traction to the bulldozer, and you think, oh, this is terrible, I mean, keel hauled through the mud and garbage is awful, help, and then as the tread goes around the frame of the bulldozer, where they have all these, you know, wheels that turn, you come out at the back end, and you go back up out of that as you're going on the top of the track. Top of the tread. Like a treadmill, okay. And you think, oh, finally I'm released from the garbage and the mud. This is great. It's wonderful. But then after a while you start looking up and say, hey, wait a minute, I seem to be going towards the front of the bulldozer again. There's something... some of my memory, I'm kind of starting to feel uncomfortable. I kind of forgot about what it was. But what was that? And before you know it, you're back on the under part of the tread in the garbage and the mud again. And you just continue on with this bulldozer. You know, that's all. You're like in this you're just like a tread on a bulldozer, thinking that you're getting liberated when you die, when you come out from the garbage and the muck of this grossness. No, you're still just a tread. The belief system is just a tread on this bulldozer, and you're going to go on the front of this. The tread's going to keep going as the bulldozer moves, and you're going to be underneath. Now, you might play the game of, we might play the game of, let's stop the bulldozer, or slow it down. Let's slow the bulldozer down. Right? You're still a tread on a bulldozer. The bulldozer can be started up again. You know, what kind of liberation is that? We don't want to be a tread on a bulldozer at all. If the tread gives traction to the bulldozer is what? The idea of absurdity. The idea of absurdity has to have traction, has to have imaginary traction. So as long as we're entertaining the absurdity, we will be a tread on a bulldozer. That's what we will imagine ourselves to be, and we'll keep going through these cycles. Gross, less gross, gross, less gross, gross, less gross. Around and around and around and around and around. So the real teachers, they liberate us from this. Of course, this is the goal. They have been liberated, and they say, you can be too. And so we're looking into liberation here, ultimate liberation. Absolutely. We might look at all these beautiful mountains, everything, and we get used to not trying to turn it into treads. Kitchen counters, tabletops, walls, shower backing, you know, all the uses that people use it for. We just get used to letting it be just the way it is. Don't do anything with it. Don't grasp it. Don't try to grasp it. Don't try to modify it. But we say, wow, we get the feeling, well, whoa, boy, if I could put this in my house, wow, what a great house. Do I have a house? Oh, yeah, I have a house. So if I wanted to, I could, at least the thought of it is still there. But I don't really want to do it. So maybe later I might want to do it, but not now. So this reduced intensity zone is like, well, maybe later I might want to do this stuff. So I want to at least see that it's possible. So at least I want to feel that I have a house. And maybe a table and counters and bathroom and stuff where I could, if I wanted to, maybe put some beautiful stone into it, but not, I don't really want to do it now. And so then we're reassured. Just let everything be just as it is there. And it seems as though, like I said, these honeycomb mounds are naturally that way. It's not like somebody carved out caves. They're natural alcoves. And just imagine like hiking through those mountains, walking through those mountains, so beautiful. And maybe they're like golf courses winding their way through the mountains too, where you can play golf and be surrounded by these beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. I mean, I'm attracted like to Arizona and the desert where they have the golf courses are built through these rock formations. It's just gorgeous. As well as parkland golf courses too, the big trees I met. There are probably some areas there also with the big, beautiful trees. That's also beautiful. So my attention is more and more focused on this reduced intensity zone realm, and less focused on this world, less and less interest in this world. So it's really like a place you want to go vacation in, and you just have to be focused on it and say, I want to take a vacation. Or so you plan your vacation, and you get your attention is focused on it so much that you're actually able to do it and do it successfully. This is what a good vacation requires. You really got to be into it. You really got to want to desire it and to leave your home behind and don't even think about it. When you really go on a great vacation, you're not even thinking about your home. I sure don't. A few chances I've had, it just, I want to forget about it for now. Fully engaged with the scenery of this vacation. I may golf later, it's possible, you know, I don't know. Maybe during the Super Bowl. There won't be anybody out there. Everybody will be watching the Super Bowl, that's for sure. It's a good time to go. You have a golf course to yourself. Right? So there's a benefit to the Super Bowl. Nobody said, what are you doing out here? Aren't you watching the Super Bowl? I says, what's my excuse? I don't know. I'll tape it. I said, well, maybe I can tape it or something. It's a good time to get out, a nice day. People might look at me strange. I say, well, you know, I'm not a big fan of the culture, you know, this kind of gross culture. I'm not a super fan of that. I'm not a super fan of it, grossness. What? That's what the yoga girls want us to do. Come on, the yoga girls saying that they'll be real sexy for us if we get into grossness. Isn't that what the yoga girls are saying? That the more grosser we go, the sexier they appear, right? Isn't that part of their game? Of course it is. Women are so gross now, it's just like, you want to throw up, really. But of course, you look back, well, they weren't so gross, you want to throw up then also, because it was just this whole fake play of subtlety. It was, you know, the flesh is just that, right? It's part of this fake play, and it's very revolting, actually, to our desire for true bliss. Realize, this doesn't have anything to do with true bliss. This is trying to deny true bliss. It's denial of it. So we had the time when women would pretend to be very refined. '50s, '60s, or '40s, '50s, '60s was a time. Very elegant, very refined, you know, just, oh, you know, football. I'm way too delicate of a beautiful flower for that. Are you kidding me? Don't even talk about it around me. You boys will go, you want to talk about it, you go to your smoking room there, you know. Me, I'm a delicate, refined flower. They had that, and now it's like, hey guys, you know, where's the cigar and whiskey and the football? Wow, this is fantastic. Unbelievably great. Just loving this. Let's boogie to this stuff, guys. And it's like, the guys are like, what? Yeah, I mean, they're smoking cigars. Like, they were into that for a while. Drinking, swigging whiskey. Whatever's gross, they're into. Leading the charge, saying, come on, guys, this is where it's really sexy down here in Grossville. Swearing would make a sailor blush, you know? The guys are saying, wow, she's more gross than we are. So I don't think I really dig that too much. I don't think I really want to go down in that grossness. But what do we do? What's the alternative? A reduced intensity zone. So I'm pioneering this here. I'm helping pioneer this. Being helped by those who are completely familiar with all these zones. Okay, like a Jesus, Nanda Maima, Rama Maharshi, Longchenpa, for example. They're totally familiar with all the zones and true bliss. Okay. So they certainly can help us who are pioneering from our perspective. the zones are there waiting for us. Say, come on in, come on in. We'd love to have you here. The mountains are calling us, saying, the alcoves are ready. Come on, everything's ready. We just need for you to decide to come here. Remember, you enter the club by being, that's what you want. Say, I want to be a member of this club. That is the one requirement to be a member, is you have to want to be a member. You have to want to go to these reduced intensity zones. And there may be a whole variety of them, but different emphasis, right? Each one helping us out in great ways. So I'm drawn to places that have really, that are surrounded by beautiful rock formations, actually. Now, it's interesting that Sedona is a very place that a lot of spiritual people go to. They may be preparing for reduced intensity zones by going there. It's supposed to have gorgeous rock formations. I've never been there, but I've seen a lot of pictures of it. Arizona has a lot of really great rock formations. That's just like Big Sur, various areas. People are drawn to those areas. Spiritual people seem to be drawn to those areas with really beautiful rock formations. This is preparing us for the zone. But what I'm doing here is I believe, more important preparation, because it's painting the overall context of the whole. Why are we going there? What's the importance of it? What's the pragmatism of it? But certainly hanging out in those rock formation areas, there's another possibility, is that they're thinking that, well, I don't really want to go there. I'm not going to go there. I'd rather try to stay here. But at least this reminds me of where I came from, or reminds me of it enough that I can at least hang on here or something. They might be using it that way too. It's possible. Try to spiritualize this world, which is what the yoga girls want. So they may be helping out the yoga girls by doing that. It could be, there could be different types. One type's using it this way, another type's using it that way. In fact, it's likely that's what happens. Doing here. Okay, it's recording. It's recording properly. That's good. I gotta check that. Now, the Palm Springs aerial tram is a fabulous practice for ascension, because you go up into this just gorgeous rock formations. Just at the base, you don't even have to take the tram if you don't want to, if you're afraid of heights or something. That the rock formations are just around, just driving up to it are spectacular. And then you go, but when you're going up in the tram, it's just like, oh my gosh, this is so beautiful. I mean, again, I would drive down there just to take the tram, like about, it costs, $20, $25 or something to take the tram. You have to pay. No, it's just. Is there a fee to get into? To even drive up there? I think there is. Yeah, there is like a $10 fee to get into the tram, and there's like $25 to take it or something. So you're talking about $35, I think. Driving down there, gas is about $2 a gallon. Say 1,000 miles. Well, let's say 30 gallons. 30 miles a gallon, 30 gallons, 900 miles. times $2, that's $60 in gas. $60 in gas. $30, $60 and $30, $100. Let's say $100, you know, basically to go on that tram ride. Now you need to stay down there at least a night, you know, so $200. If you average it out, you go with a number of people. But this is doable. I mean, I'm considering doing that actually. I'm really considering doing that. I'll drive through the Mojave Desert on the way, where there's spectacular rock formations in the Mojave Desert. There's a back way to go. It's spectacular. Wow. I think I may do that coming up, actually, if God has some way to funds. I don't have the funds, but we'll see. I mean, wow. Because when you go up in the top of the tram, too, and you're hiking up there, this, again, spectacular rock formations, is just gorgeous. And it feels like you've gone into another realm up there. It really does. It's just wow. It is really, I wow. I was thinking of where to go. I can't think of anywhere to go. So this is one place I would think to go. And it gives a profound experience that it's something that definitely helps with ascension. Wow, now I'm fired up for this. I'm gonna start talking about this and see what happens. So I would say stone formations are a major part right now of helping us out. I'm producing graphics for you to help you also. This is very important. Now, after having gone to this realm now and seeing what's there, I'm saying it's very possible that we will spend our time in these mountains, in these beautiful alcoves there. We may start out just in certain areas not so beautiful, and then gradually go to more and more and more beautiful areas there. It's just probably just, yeah, there may be areas that this whole area is just, you know, the areas that are like just these cut slabs of cut diamonds interspersed with gold and you know, just, I mean, whatever, just beauty that is just astonishing, you know, we would find just so astonishing here. Like the cut glass ceilings in India, some of the royal palaces are supposed to be quite astonishing. But that's nothing compared to the beauty of these mountains. That wouldn't even be a side attraction. We just wouldn't even pay attention to it. It's so much more beautiful there. Wow. Well, I'll pray for some funds to do this. And those of you who enjoyed the video of ascending up there, this is a very strong sign that you may be going to the reduced intensity zone soon. Very, very strong sign. Not many people watched the videos, actually, but those who did, they said that, wow, love it, love it, love it, love it. This is a very strong indication. So you better keep doing your homework. You know, better get with it. I wanted to drive through Sedona, actually, the vacation I took, but there was some impediments that came up. I wasn't able to do it. That's okay. Everything turned out great. But if you're near Sedona, you might want to go through those mountains there, too. Absolutely. So I didn't really see trees in the mountains, okay? I didn't see trees, no. At least some of the mountains I was looking at, it's like, these are what, barren mountains, no trees or what? Oh, but the rock formations and the beauty of the rock formations, holy cow. Maybe there's a few trees here and there, that's fine, right? I was supposed there would be some. But it's not like a forested mountain where it's just, you know, like the Santa Cruz Mountains, just completely full of it, conifers, you know. It's really, when you get up there, it's not very pretty at all, actually. It's all dark and shady, and there's no sunlight. I don't like those type of mountains. I prefer the dry mountains and the rock formations. Like a Pinnacles National Monument. That's beautiful. I used to spend a lot of time there, actually. Hiking, taking pictures, taking video. I wanted to recommend it to people. I've been working on this for a long time, actually. It's just that people don't understand what I'm talking about. So I get discouraged. But I tried to find all these places in California for people to go to these places. This will really help you. No interest. Zero interest. So it's pretty hard to sustain anything if there's zero interest. But I've had to sustain my own interest. But, you know, if you're not interested at this point, maybe tomorrow you will be. Like that kind of thing. This is how I'm looking at it. Because you can't help but recognize the grossness that the yoga girls and artificial intelligence and tech people, the slick marketing folks, are pointing us towards, saying, go down in that pit. I'll see you down there. Yoga girls say, I'll see you down there. You know, they're telling everybody to get down in this dark pit. And then they're you know, waving from up above, kind of a little bit. Like, hi, yeah. You're doing great. Go a little deeper down there. It's doing great. Yeah, I'll be right down there with you soon. You know. And they're leading excursions down into the pit also. Grand Canyon is, speaking of something, a pit. Grand Canyon rock formations also. I've never been there either. I want to go there too. But there are a lot of beautiful rock formations, like in the United States and all over the world, actually. You don't have to see them all. In fact, you know, some of the artwork I'm doing is even more evocative, you might say, very evocative. And in our mind, in my mind, I can starting to even see. And you can also visit tile shops and go look at the slabs. You know, you need to start doing. I've been doing all this stuff, actually. Just the Holy Spirit just has me doing this stuff. I wasn't really sure exactly why. Now I'm seeing why. Keep in mind that many of the great ones who have been liberated from absurdity, a lot of them spent their lives in caves. Longchenpa spent most of his life in caves. Absolutely. These caves are, you know, gorgeous, a lot of them, really. Their location, the structure, the slabs, it is quite beautiful, really. They're not really caves that I saw in this room. It's alcoves, airy alcoves, kind of like honeycombed. Something like maybe Gaudi, you know, architect Gaudi would make it very baroque-ish in terms of lots of niches and alcoves and beautiful. It's not like some heavy dark cave where you're like back in the darkness or anything like that. And the mountains are such that it seems like the light would get to everybody nicely. You know, it's kind of like these spires, sort of, a lot of spires everywhere, kind of, that go up where they're not blocking the light too much from anyone else. It's just the way they look. They say, that looks really nice. Wow. Very intriguing. Very intention, catching your attention. So, wow. So again, these realms are for those who are aware of what their purpose is, to get free of the chain of this chain of existence, this treadmill of existence. Understanding our continuity, fear, and the habits of attention we have, taking those into account, but helping us get free of those habits. And it's not just a subtle realm within the chain of existence. It's a realm prepared by the grace of God to enable us to get free of this chain of existence and all the subtlety involved in that, actually. The so-called subtlety, which really is not subtlety, it's just lots of ornamentation that we impute subtlety to it, gradations of subtlety to it. So I'm focusing in now on my intent here. Let's see what happens with that. This concierge once told me, I used to get guys up to this golf course. It was just absolutely beautiful. The rock formations, you cannot believe how beautiful this is, but the membership filled up. I can't do it anymore. I thought, because it's funny, because I was aware of that golf course. Almost no one is aware of it. And I said, I want to go there. I want to play there. I want to be a member up in that area because of the rock formations. Never happened. But my intent was to live among these rock formations, this beautiful this area, live there. And it didn't happen. And I'm not thrilled that it didn't happen. I really wanted it to happen. Now, maybe if I gave the concierge $500, you know, and said, hey, you know, if you got a buddy up there, make it happen. Can you make it happen for $500? He might be able to make it happen. That's possible. If I had the money, I'd do stuff. I'd do things like that right now. Because he said, he said, it is just out of this world spectacular, actually. It's built right in the side of a mountain. The whole thing is in this rock mountain, is right in the side of it. And he says, oh my God, you're just these massive slabs of stone everywhere, and you're just standing there in space almost. He's just like, wow. Yeah. Let's see what the Holy Spirit can do now. This is really tremendously interesting, this point. Coastline in Monterey, Carmel, Big Sur is very beautiful with rock formations around the coast. It's gorgeous, yeah, absolutely. But of course, we're not doing this to try to keep ourselves attracted to this world. Say, oh yeah, there's plenty of nice rock formations in this world. No, from what I've seen now, it cannot touch this reduced intensity zone. I mean, it's a faint echo of it. The stuff we have here, faint echo. So it's not like we're trying to, again, say, this world's good enough. No, because look at all the difficulty we have to even get to these places, the expense and everything. I can't even do it because of the expense. Where there, you literally are able to dwell in these places. You have this unlimited number of beautiful alcoves that just... You're just surrounded by this stunning beauty all the time. And you say, well, if I wanted to leave this, I could. I got a house down in the valley, but, you know, maybe later I'll do that. I wonder if those who come from reduced intensity zones live in the mountains here, like the Himalayas, because it's very similar, and it helps them a little bit coming into this world, stay in touch with that realm. They don't feel comfortable not being around this type of beauty. They would just want wander through the Himalayas, a lot of them actually. Where you do see, indeed see, massive amount of course, rock, stone formations and just every kind of array, so many different arrays, but it's nothing compared to what I'm envisioning now. And there's no snow, no cold there. I didn't see any coldness there at all. There's no evidence of that sort of mountainous region. They're not high mountains either. Not real high. At least what I saw. What's that? I think maybe it's the Blue Angels that are going to fly over Levi Stadium at kickoff. But, you know, another gross thing. All these helicopters everywhere. Roar of attack jets, you know. Very gross, isn't it? This is not our thing here. We're not here to celebrate grossness. Be engrossed. It's interesting, a lot of like the Hindu temples, like especially in southern India, very strong resemblance to what I saw in a reduced intensity zone. Although they're all contrived here, there in reduced intensity zone, it's all natural, the honeycombing. But you look at some of these great, like at Tiruvannamalai, I believe, some of these gigantic stone temples that the Hindus built. Very strong resemblance, actually. All the niching and the honeycombing and the way it is. Yeah, very similar. Well, there's a striking similitude to them. But what I saw in the dream, it's all natural, very natural. It's all naturally formed that way. And, of course, in the temples, you just have cut stone they cut out and they had to build it this way. But so the beauty is not there in terms of all the different striations and patterns of the rock that's possible. But wow, very strong resemblance. Some of the Buddhist temples also, see, this stuff comes from those who come from reduced intensity zones to try to help attract us to these zones. They come into this world and have helped us throughout history. You're starting to see this now. And of course, many of the meditators, they just live in these places. Like Ramana Maharshi went near one of these places, right? And just hung out in this type of area. So all this gorgeous stonework in this world is really just an attempt to at least provide a faint echo of how beautiful this reduced intensity zone is. The beauty that is there for us to get used to. Yeah, it'll be a gradual process of getting used to it, really. Just like going into a tile slab store, stone slab. I mean, it's a mind blower, but after a while you kind of get used to it, and it's not so, you know, it's just like, okay, it's beautiful, but it's not such a big wow. Yeah, it takes a while. Doing an hour and a half on this one. Yeah. Very intense here. Well, the Dead Sea area, Qumran scrolls, Dead Sea scrolls, those also all these alcoves right in the stony area. The Jews wandering in the Sinai Peninsula, a lot of rocky area, beautiful rocky features there too, right? Maybe that has some reference to a reduced intensity zone. Carvings in the cliffs all over the world, the Nile area and things, trying to evoke that in some way. But there's nothing like actually going there and living there. I mean, this world's the booby prize. Come on. Once you start seeing this realm, like we say, wow, this is way, way better here. This will help free me from this attempt to manufacture false bliss. A false bliss. That's a nasty, nasty, terrible endeavor to be engaged in, and we need to get free of that. I pretty much maxed out on the wow here, I feel like. This is extreme intensity. Now, I could attach some of these pictures, graphics, to the end of this video. It's something I could do. Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, I don't know if I will or not. Okay. It just depends on what the Holy Spirit sort of indicates to me, just like what feels right. But these are just a faint echo, so to speak. I have to stress the homeliness of the place, the alcoves, the honeycombed alcoves, just like, this is so beautiful. This was wonderful. It's better than any house I could ever have. It is unbelievably great. I have access to all this beauty, and I can still live here and dwell here. And, oh my gosh, this is so amazingly beautiful and so welcoming, so comfortable. It's not just a house. It feels like home. That's what's really important. It's part of what's very important. So much so that we feel that the old suburban tract home doesn't seem so attractive at all anymore. It's some, you know, antique relic that we might want to go visit occasionally and say, if I, you know, it reminds me of the past. I'm not really into that so much anymore. So, yeah, we could select that. Now, of course, here in this world, we have tried to simulate this, and so, you know, so we can be gross and happy at the same time. We're trying to find bliss, fake bliss. So in order to do this, we have to provide this gross contrast, and it still doesn't work. But so as we're doing this real grossness here, we're trying to at least get some beauty so we can keep working on it. And, you know, that. So it doesn't necessarily mean that's any sort of spiritual advancement to try to beautify this world. It's more likely we're trying to just stay engaged with this effort to create fake bliss, and we're getting tired of it. And we say, well, I better do some beautification here, and I'm getting tired of it. So there needs to be a very much conscious awareness of what we're doing here, and contextually, you know. Otherwise, it may just be, again, that we're trying to just stay engaged with this by trying to beautify stuff here. Yeah. I think there's enough natural beauty in this world to remind us that we don't really have to try and do anything else about it. It's more important to focus on the context and the purpose. And you can see in your mind and visit in dreams, go in dreams like I just did, and go there. You can actually go there. Go there in your dreams. Have your intention to do this. And I'm saying it's possible. It's absolutely possible. The journey there wasn't any trouble at all. And getting there, being there wasn't any trouble. But I realized, wow, this is a different realm. And I wasn't freaked out by it or anything. I was still kind of calm, but I realized this is kind of a challenge. This is going to be a bit of a challenge. But I felt like, well, maybe I can take this challenge on. I didn't commit to it yet. I said, maybe I need to find out a little bit more about it, which is what I'm doing now. What's the good? What are the good aspects here? What's the, you know? But I didn't feel in over my head exactly. Not exactly. I said, what am I facing here? Kind of thing. Okay, but everything went well, as far as it went. Everything went very well. And nobody was singling me out, or who's that guy, or saying anything. Everybody just minded their own business. I didn't feel like I was intruding upon anything. In fact, I didn't see a whole lot of people. There's some guy at the gas station that I asked about it. I said, yeah, but he didn't seem like he was necessarily bound to the gas station as a job. He just happened to be there at that moment. Maybe he's there to field questions with new arrivals. Is that those things right? I need to gas up my car. And so he's there. Yes, it's not really a technology there. It's just we have these gas, have this gas station here for folks who want to drive in here. And okay. So that, yeah, this hit my nerves about as hard as I can hit my nerves right now at this moment. So I don't want to overdo it. This will become the new normal. This will become the new normal. And we'll look back on this and say, well, that's a great milestone, you know. But first we have to make it the new normal. Don't struggle with it. Just get used to it. Don't struggle. Just get used to it. Don't try to put it in a time context. It's just right now is I'm getting used to the new normal right here, right now. That's it. Part of the intensity is I'm seeing the validity of this more and more. And historically, too, I say, wow. So this is what it's all about. Yeah, it fits. It really fits. So it means it seems more and more legitimate that this is legitimately going to happen. So this is, of course, much greater intensity. It's not just some pie in the sky. It's I'm seeing the pattern of preparation for this in my life, and I say, oh my gosh, there's no question that there's been a pattern of preparation for this, and it fits this realm that I was in. So there's a strong, plausible inference now in this direction, very strong. And this is the intensity, the wow intensity of this, like, wow, this may very well happen. This may very well be what is going to take place in our experiencing. So that needs to become the new normal, just to adjust to that. That's part of the bigger context now. The world is just a gross level to provide contrast to some supposedly more subtle level, which is supposed then to be defined as blissful level. And our experiencing here is part of that grossness. And we're trying to make it more gross now. Superficially, more slick and sophisticated with all this technology. But in our attitudes and action, and more engrossed into the body, way more engrossed than we used to be, actually. Well, we've gone in phases here. We're just trying to bring about a sybaritic existence here that is totally focused on the body and body sensations and all of that. Very gross. And there's no question this is taking place. So there's no questioning the overall, you know, all the evidence is unquestionable. And then where it points to is plausible inference is very strong. We don't need to say more than that. I mean, it's just how it is right now. And you know, we'll see how it goes. I tend to be more attracted to like golf courses with beautiful rock formations than I am like a park thing, like an ocean thing, like Pebble Beach. People say like Pebble Beach, oh, Jack Nicklaus said if I could only play one more golf course in my life, it would be Pebble Beach. Say, okay, well there are some cliffs there and some rock formations, yeah, sure. So I'll give it that. But when I imagine a beautiful golf course designing one, it winds. It's up in the mountains and low foothills, but rocky. Foothill, and it winds itself throughout these beautiful rock formations and boulders and all this kind of stuff. This is what I would envision for a golf course I want to play on. I don't know too many courses that are like that. So again, I would say this is an extreme intensity video. I'm feeling extreme intensity here of now focus and determination. It's like, oh, okay. You know, so the Super Bowl did not knock me off this focus, you see. Not yet. It's coming up. But the preparation for all the hoopla, I didn't pay any attention to it at all. I've been totally focused on this, which is important. The event will be, you know, over with by this evening, and then the, you know, wind down the confetti and talk about it and blah blah blah. After a week or so, you know, it'll be drifting away to some extent, although they'll try to probably keep it in our consciousness in some way for a long time. Okay, well. We're just giving this some time here. The intensity's off the charts. So, we just ask the Holy Spirit to make it happen for us. Make it happen. Anything, any preparation we need. Now, make it happen for us. Right now. Make it happen for us right now. What more can I say? Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.